Bolinda Audiobooks presents this unabridged recording of Famous for 5 Minutes, written by Margaret Clark and read by Peter Hardy. Be sure to visit our website at www.bolinda.com. Details of other available and forthcoming Bolinda audiobook releases can be found at the end of this recording. The dedication reads, "For Kylie, Jade, Rebecca, Robin, Emma, Kathleen, DJ, Michelle, Rita, Bree, Amy, Gemma, Andrew, and the Coppin Farm Young Writers Group, and the band She Freak." Chapter 1. Year 8 and feeling great. Until I hit school. I'd forgotten how grim, how organised it is, especially when they send in Poxon to sort us out. Poxy Poxon. Kids reckon he used to run a karate school before he joined up as a teacher. He's a lean, mean teaching machine. First thing he does is split us from our mates so as we won't feel too secure. Then he starts in on our appearance. "What's that in your hair, Ravolini?" "A Bon Jovi scarf, sir." "Say bon voyage to the Bon Jovi scarf, Ravolini." "What's that on your feet, Peters?"
"Shoes, sir."
"Shoes? They look more like plaster casts." "Nikes, sir." "Let the Nikes take a hike, Peters." "Yes, sir." This is going to be a long year. The good news is that he's going to be our year coordinator, which means we won't have him all day long. The bad news is that we'll see him first period every day for a year, not counting Saturdays, Sundays or public holidays. Big deal. He spouts the usual drivel, how he wants us to be mature and make our own decisions. No bashing up the new kids, no hogging the lockers, no skidding across the washroom floors, no racking off at lunchtimes without a pass, no smoking in the dunnies, but be mature and make your own decisions. Yeah. We're wrapped. Next thing, Orlando starts in. He's the Year 8 hero, a real chill-out dude. He's knocking out a rap tune on the desktop, just to see how far he can go. "Who's making that noise?" Poxon peers round the room. Orlando is sitting, innocent-like. He starts up again. He's living on the razor's edge. "Okay," says Poxon. "What's your game, Orlando? Morse code to the Russians?" "Very good, sir," says Orlando politely. "But I'm actually practicing." "Practicing, Orlando?" "Drums, sir." "Well, I'd start practicing the death march if I was you, because if you don't stop the tapping right now, you're dead." Orlando shrugs. He's got the attention he wants. He's taken the measure of Poxon, and Poxon sure as hell knows he exists. "Year 8," says Poxon, "is a serious year." We looked suitably impressed. "This is the year when you're expected to knuckle down." Turk puts up his hand. "Does that mean we can muck around in years 9, 10, 11 and 12, sir?" "What did I say, Turkerton?" "This is a serious year, sir." "I said, be mature and make your own decisions." "What do you intend to do with your life, Turkerton?" "Be a rock star, sir." There's a subdued titter through the room. Poxon nods his head up and down as if in deepest thought. "And how many of you would share this noble ambition?" "Huh?" Gonzo in the front seat can only understand short sentences, like one word. "Who else wants to be a rock star?" A forest of hands shoots skywards. "So, we have a surplus of rock stars. A potential overload. What would your second choice be, Turkerton?"
"A teacher, sir."
"Ah. And do you know how many years you have to study to be a teacher, Turkerton?"
"One, sir."
"Year 12. Plus 4 years of university, boy. Not many of you clowns are going to be rock stars, and certainly not many will be teachers, or architects, or scientists, or anything. Do you know why I've got a teaching diploma, Orlando?"
"'Cause you weren't bright enough to be a brain surgeon, sir?"
"Because I put my head down and studied, Orlando. Studied. I respected my teachers. I learned from them. I didn't cruise around until all hours playing pinball machines and hooning about." Orlando shrugs. "Not our fault you was deprived, sir." I think Poxon is going to blow a fuse, but he contains himself. "At least I'm not depraved, as some of your graffiti efforts would suggest you are, sonny boy. Now, Let's see if he can behave like Year 8s and not a bunch of cretins let loose from the city zoo. He starts reading out a million items of breathtaking interest from the Daily Bulletin. Absolutely mind-blowing stuff about the debating team, the Shakespeare Club. Is that a disco? Canteen prices, tryouts for sports teams. Orlando makes spitballs from his notepad and flicks them onto the ceiling with his ruler. Maria Ravolini winds her Bon Jovi scarf around her arm like a colour gangband. Turk is engraving his name in the desk with his biro. The bell rings. End of the session. End of Poxon for one whole day. But wait. We have to choose a colour for our year level. Of course, someone else has bagged crimson, black, purple and silver. But how? I ask. Seeing as this is the first day and all. He doesn't know. He says. Rigged again. Well, we don't want some poncy colour like pink or lemon, says Muggsy. Someone else has got those too, he says. Oh, yeah? How about tartan, says Orlando. Bet no one's got tartan then. That stumped him. Bet you there's never been a Year 8 tartan in the whole of Australia before. What colour did you want, sir? Asked Spitbush, cunning-like. It was clear as the horns on a bull that the teachers had picked the colours. Well, gold? We howl him down. Tartan! 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 We chant. We couldn't have tartan. Too hard to draw, tartan. So, we go for cobalt. None of your poncy blues. Cobalt. So here we are, Year 8 cobalt. Raring to go. All these scared little Year 7s are hovering round the door waiting to get into the room. Their teacher, Miss Bronte, is with them. I had her last year for English, and I reckon she's got to be the best English teacher in the school. I give her a grin as I exit. She winks back. Hi, Miss Bronte, comes the chorus. Hi, Orlando. Hi, Craig. Hi, Maria. Knows all our names, too, which is more than some teachers do. At least she bothers. We troop off to English, and guess who we've got? Dr. Doolittle himself, Goony Mooney. He's got this long hair, see? Well, that's cool, you say. But this is not cool hair. No dreadlocks, no spiral perm. This is long, lanky and flat like squid's tentacles. He's got these little granny glasses that makes his eyes look like boiled golf balls. And this permanently smiling mouth that makes him look kind of pious. Like he's the 12 apostles rolled into one. He's some kind of freak. He's out to reform the world and we're first in line. The major problem is he doesn't believe in violence. Peace be with you, he says as we take our seats. Poor bloke. He must have got a bum steer at the careers office. He wasn't cut out to be a teacher. He should have been a Bible basher selling pamphlets door to door, or a guru sitting in a cave in India. Right, he says. Let's get one thing straight. We can see his mouth moving, but the sound's kind of distorted, due to the fact that Maria and Joanne are screeching the latest details of their love lives. Or lies. They read Sweet Dreams for thrills. And Turk and Spitbush are talking footy scores, and everyone else is starting to gab it up. Belt up, I roar. Give the man a go. Everyone belts up. Go on, sir, I say. Thank you, Nutt, he says. Let's explain here. He's not being rude or sarcastic. Nutt is my surname, and no one in this form makes anything of it, because I'll knock their teeth down to their toes. Soon as I was old enough to wake up to the fact that me dad had called me Peter, initial P, Nutt, I decided to take up karate and other forms of self-defence. Dad's name is Wal, Mum's is Ginger, and me big brother's name's Chess. I asked me dad once why he called us names to go with Nutt, and he said people were going to comment anyway, so may as well give him something worthwhile. Goony Mooney gazes heavenwards, clasping his hand in front like he's praying. Our term project in English is to write a major play and act it out, he says. A play, huh? Can it be a musical? I says, thinking of the lead vocal. Yeah, like Hair, says Orlando, thinking of the nude scenes. I had in mind more a modern-day version of Romeo and Juliet, says Mooney. He's away with the pixies. Forest scene. I could see it on his face. But, sir, we can't write our own play, says Joanne, inspecting her fingernails, which are vivid purple. It'll take us ages. And I can't write, says Spitbush. Wait! We all swivel our eyes to Mooney. He's flapping his arms like he's going to go into orbit, trying to get our attention. He'll teach us characterisation, he says. It's dead easy. Like, two volunteers, he says. Me. I had my hand up first. Nutt and Ravolini, he says. Who, me? Didn't even have my hand up, but... A phone conversation, says Mooney, between a girl and a boy. A simple scenario. It'll be simple, all right, if it was anything to do with Maria Ravolini. Can I be the girl? I say, and the class cracks up. Be yourself, says Mooney. Okay, no problems. I dial the imaginary phone. Fake! Screams Turk. She'd be phoning you, mate. True. I wait. And wait. Come on, I say to Ravolini. Start dialing. Waiting for me nails to dry, she says. I told you. Thick. Mooney is starting to fall apart with frustration. Start a dialogue, he says. Do I have to? Yes! For someone who believes in peace, he's starting to crack 'em bad. Hello? Is this Peter Nutt? Says Ravolini. Course it's me, I say. Who'd you think, Peter Moon? Sting? Madonna? The class is breaking up. Quiet! Yells Mooney. They clam. We're still testing how far we can go. What do you want? I say into my pretend receiver. Will you churn with me, Peter Nutt? Ooh! Yells the class. Woo-hoo! I go bright red and drop my imaginary phone. I think this playwriting's dumb, I say to Mooney, just as the bell rings. Yeah, plays are dead boring, says Orlando. Unless we do hair. Homework, bleats Mooney as we herd towards the door. What? Homework? On the first day? You gotta be joking. Read the first scene of Romeo and Juliet. Be prepared to discuss it in class. Oh, sir, I'm not joking, Spitbush. That's one thing they don't joke about here. Homework. And if you don't do it, you don't get to go on excursions or sports days. Simple as that. And who wants to miss out on the only decent things that happen at school? We do our homework. Well, nearly always. Sometimes you can fake that you handed it in with some of the denser teachers, but not very often. I bash my way down the corridor. Timetables, timetables. Life here is one massive timetable. It's maths. Who'll we have? Some soft apology for a teacher? Or some brilliant brain who could win sale of the century hands down, but can't teach kids for nuts? Or some gifted genius who can actually add two and two and make it dead interesting? But it's a new one. Teaching diploma still wet in her hand. Good morning, class, she says, nervous as. We're cobalt, says Orlando. Like a bolt out of the blue, says Turk. Everyone cracks up. Silence, she yells. I glare around. Oh, shut up and give her a go. Now, don't get me wrong. I ain't no teacher lover, but I don't want to spend my whole year doing detention. She raves on how maths is exciting only if you're prepared to try. Today, she says brightly, we're going to experiment with space and number. Good, says Peters. Can we go outside? Because there isn't enough space in here. What a great idea, she says, pleased that we sound enthusiastic. We'll take out these problem cards and these measuring tapes, and we'll find out the answers to the questions through concrete examples. One card between two. There's a brawl to decide who'll work with whom. Boy, has she got a lot to learn. As the noise becomes deafening, she looks helplessly at me. I shrug. I've helped her once. That's it. Who's getting paid $30,000 to run this show? Not me. Eventually, everyone quietens. All right, she says. Off you go. Big mistake. The kids take off, right across the oval, disappearing into the distance as she yells at them to come back. Oval out of bounds, I say conversationally, as she gives chase. Another mistake. You should have said so, miss. Tell you what, she's not a bad runner, especially with high heels on too. The kids are nearly out of sight and half the school is hanging out the windows watching. Miss kicks off her shoes and goes like stink. I'm just standing, watching. Stupid to get up a sweat. I sit on the edge of the oval and wait for him to come back. She's rounded them up and the troops are returning like a buffalo stampede. Someone's nicked her shoes. She's nearly bawling. Give her the shoes, I say, as everyone falls in a panting heap. Come on, who's got them? Give them or I'll punch out your lights. You, Lisa Freeman? Yeah, that'd be right. Miss puts on her shoes, trembling. We still don't know your name, I point out. I'm the only one who's got breath left to speak. My name's Miss Melrose and I'm getting mad, she says. Good. She might turn out okay yet. Do not leave the school boundaries. Here, there, there, there. Got it? Now, start measuring. Geez, you can run, miss, says Turk admiringly. That
was my first choice. We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.